Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome T.C. Boyle.
Oh, hello, folks. Thank you for that welcome. I have to admit that the weather here is disturbing to me. I live in Santa Barbara. We haven't seen rain in 5 years. I was hoping it would be raining like holy hell today, but I'm sorry, we're not getting that. The drought of 5 years. So my wife and I bathe together so we can save the water, of course, once a month. And then we take that water and we pick the laundry and wash the laundry in it. What's left over, we boil the spaghetti and throw on the lawn. So, you guys are lucky. You have actual rain here. Ariel's introduction was wonderful. Thank you, Ariel. He gave you the essential idea of what I'm writing about in the Terranauts. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. But then, because this is the last gig that I have to do on a long book tour that's taken me to 13 cities. By the way, I've flown so much, the pilot lets me sit up front and fly the plane myself now. I'm going to read you a new story today, and it'll be story time. I had asked that we could turn the lights down a little, so it's not so much like an interrogation center, but it seems too complicated. I don't know why we can't turn the lights down. Anyway, so as Ariel said, I have picked up the story of Biosphere 2, and I've got all the actual history of what happened. So this is in Arizona, 91 through 93, you may remember. It was a big news event. These eight people were selected from 16 to live in an artificial environment. Could we have an off-Earth colony? Or if, you'll excuse the expression, if the original biosphere that we're in right now should turn to Maird, where are we gonna go? So, it wasn't really science because there was no theory that was being tested. It was just a kind of theatrical thing. Hey kids, let's all go inside for 2 years and see what happens. This was supposed to be the first of 50 two-year closures. Four men, four women, one of whom is a doctor for obvious reasons. They're going to be sealed in. So they have to generate their own oxygen. It was the hardest thing, even when on a cloudy day, the CO2 levels would go up. Finally, in the second year, they had to break closure and bring in oxygen because it was like living at 12,000 feet. People were getting headaches from oxygen deprivation, etc. They were starving. If only Jenny Craig had known about this, because the men lost 18% of their body weight, the women 10%. They were living on 1,500 calories a day. That's the best they could do. So I had all the original history, and this was projected to be 50 two-year closures. It would be going on now. This would be like the 12th closure. However, it was a private enterprise funded by a friendly billionaire. And you know how erratic they can be. And a creator. 6 months into the second closure, they had an argument. That was it. That was the end of it. It's not closed anymore. You can see it as a tourist site. Architecturally, it's amazing. But the whole idea that was so exciting to me at that time was no matter what happens in there, they cannot open the airlock. Unfortunately, I lost interest in that day, as much of the public did, because one of the women cut off the tip of her finger in the rice hulling machine 12 days in. And yes, the doctor sewed it back up, but it wasn't looking real good. And finally, they had to take her out to the hospital for 5 hours and do a proper job on it. Okay, she was only out in our atmosphere for 5 hours, but it kind of blew the whole thing. So eventually they began to send their blood samples out and so on. So it wasn't absolute closure. I have now written a second closure where they are taking advantage of what happened in the first one, and no matter what happens, no matter who does what to whom, they're not going to open that airlock. I didn't realize, by the way, how incredibly sexy this book was going to be. What are they going to do in there? Four men, four women, 2 years, sealed inside? You'll find out. So in the meanwhile, I would love to deliver you this story, which just appeared in the New Yorker 2 years ago, two weeks ago, what am I saying? And this is my newest obsession. It's with CRISPR-Cas9 technology. This is the new gene editing technology, which enables us quite quickly and easily to transfer genes from one species into another. I subscribe to nature and science both, and I've noticed over the past year, and some of you may have noticed this too, right inside the cover, sometimes obscuring the cover, is a huge ad. It shows a fist in a boxing glove, and it's punching, and it says, "Knock out any gene." They are selling these kits to anybody to make transgenic bacteria and transgenic mold in your own kitchen for fun. Now, is this a good idea? Listen and find out. So, this story is called, "Are We Not Men?" The dog was the color of a maraschino cherry, and what it had in its jaws, I couldn't quite make out at first, not until it parked itself under the hydrangeas and began throttling the thing. This little episode would have played itself out without my even noticing, except that I'd gone to the stove to put on the kettle for a cup of tea and happened to glance out the window at the front lawn. The lawn, a deep, lush blue-green that managed to hint at both the turquoise of the sea and the viridian of a Kentucky meadow, was something I took special pride in, and any wandering dog, no matter its chromatics, was an irritation to me. The seed had been pricey, a blend of chewings, fescue, bahia, and zoysia incorporating a gene from a species of algae that allowed it to glow under the porch light at night. And while it was both disease and drought resistant, it didn't take well to foot traffic, especially four-footed traffic. I stepped out on the porch and clapped my hands, thinking to shoo the dog away, but it didn't move. Well, actually it did, but only to flex its shoulders and tighten its jaws around its prey, which I now saw was my neighbor Allison's pet micro pig. The pig itself, doe-eyed and no bigger than a Pekingese, didn't seem to be struggling, or not any longer. And even as I came down off the porch, looking to grab the first thing I could find to brandish at the dog, I felt my heart thundering. Allison was one of those pet owners who tend to anthropomorphize their animals, and that pig was the center of her unmarried and unboyfriended life. She would be shattered, absolutely, and who was going to break the news to her? I felt a surge of anger. How had the stupid thing got out of the house anyway? And for that matter, whose dog was this? I didn't own a garden rake, and there were no sticks on the lawn. The street trees were an edited variety that didn't drop anything, not twigs, seeds, or leaves, no matter the season. So I stormed across the grass, empty-handed, shouting the first thing that came to mind, which was, "Bad! Bad dog!" I wasn't thinking. And the effect wasn't what I would have hoped for, even if it had been. The dog dropped the pig all right, which was clearly beyond revivification at that point. But in the same motion, it lurched up and clamped its jaws on my left forearm, growling continuously as if my forearm were a stick it had fetched in a friendly game between us. Curiously, there was no pain, and no blood either, just a firm, insistent pressure. The saliva hopped and wet on my skin as I pulled in one direction, and the dog, all the while regarding me out of a pair of dull, uniform eyes, pulled in the other. "Let go," I demanded. But the dog didn't let go. "Bad dog," I repeated. I tugged. The dog tugged back. There was no one on the street, no one in the next yard over, no one in the house behind me to come to my aid. I was dressed in the t-shirt, shorts, and slippers I'd pulled on not 10 minutes earlier when I'd got out of bed. And here I was, caught up in this maddening interspecies pas de deux at 8 a.m. of an otherwise ordinary day, already exhausted. The dog, this cherry red, hairless freak with the armored skull and bulging musculature of a pit bull, showed no sign of giving in. It had got my arm, and it meant to keep it. After a minute of this, I went down on one knee to ease the tension in my back, a gesture that only seemed to excite the animal all the more, its nails tearing up divots as it fought for purchase, trying, it occurred to me now, to bring me down to its level. Before I knew what I was doing, I balled up my free hand and punched the thing in the head 3 times in quick succession. The effect was instantaneous. The dog dropped my arm and let out a yelp, backing off to hover at the edge of the lawn and eye me warily, as if now, all at once, the rules of the game had changed. In the next moment, just as I realized that I was, in fact, bleeding, a voice cried out behind me, "Hey, I saw that!" A girl was striding across the lawn toward me, a preternaturally tall girl I at first took to be a teenager, but was actually a child of 11 or 12. As soon as she appeared, the dog fell in step with her and everything became clear. She marched directly up to me, glaring, and said, "You hit my dog." I was in no mood. "I'm bleeding," I said, holding out my arm in evidence. "You see this? Your dog bit me. You ought to keep him chained up." "That's not true. Ruby would never bite anybody. She was just playing is all." I wasn't about to debate her. This was my property, my arm. And that lump of flesh lying there bleeding into the grass was Allison's dead pet. I pointed to it. "Oh," she said, her voice dropping. "I'm so sorry, I didn't, is it yours?" "It's my neighbor's," I said. I gestured to the house just visible over the hedge. "She's gonna be devastated. This pig," I wanted to call it by name, personalize it, but for the life of me, couldn't remember it, "is all she has. And it wasn't cheap either." I glanced at the dog, its pinkish gaze and incarnadine flanks, as I'm sure you can appreciate. The girl, who stood 3 or 4 inches taller than me, and whose own eyes were an almost iridescent shade of violet that didn't exist in nature, or at least hadn't until recently, gave me an unflinching look. "Maybe she doesn't have to know." "What do you mean she doesn't have to know? The thing's dead, look at it." "Maybe it was run over by a car. You want me to lie to her?" The girl shrugged. The dog, panting, settled down on its haunches. "I already said I'm sorry. Ruby got out the front gate when my mother went to work, and I came right after her. You saw me." "What about this?" I demanded, holding up my arm, which wasn't so much punctured as abraded, since most of the new breeds had their canines and carnassials genetically modified to prevent any real damage in situations like this. "It has its shots, right?" "She's a cherry pit," the girl said, giving me a look of disgust. "Germline immunity comes with the package. I mean, everybody knows that." It was a Tuesday, and I was working from home as I did every Tuesday and Thursday. I worked in IT like practically everybody else on the planet, and I found I actually got more done at home than when I went into the office. My coworkers were a trial, what with their moods, opinions, facial tics, and all the rest. Not that I didn't like them. It was just that they always seemed to manage to get in the way at crunch time. Or maybe I didn't like them. Maybe that was it. At any rate, after the little contretemps with the girl and her dog, I went back in the house, smeared an antibiotic ointment on my forearm, took my tea and a handful of protein wafers to my desk, and sat down at the computer. If I gave the dead pig a thought, it was only in relation to Allison. Who'd want to see the corpse, I supposed, which brought up the question of what to do with it. Let it lie where it was, or stuff it in a trash bag and refrigerate it till she got home from the office? I thought of calling my wife. Connie was regional manager of Bank USA, by necessity a master of interpersonal relations, and she would know what to do. But then, it was hardly worth bothering her at work over something so trivial. I could have buried the corpse, I suppose, or tossed it in the trash and played dumb, but in the end, I wound up doing nothing. It was past 3 by the time I thought to take a lunch break, and because it was such a fine day, I brought my sandwich and a glass of iced tea out onto the front lawn. By this juncture, I'd forgotten all about the pig, the dog, and the grief that was brewing for Allison, but as soon as I stepped out the door, it all came back to me. The trees were alive with crow parrots, variously screeching, cawing, and chattering amongst themselves, and they were there for a very specific reason. I don't know if you have crow parrots in your neighborhood yet, but believe me, they're coming. They were the inspiration of one of the molecular embryologists at the university here, who felt that inserting genes of the common crow into the invasive parrot population would put an end to the parrots' raids on our orchards and vineyards, giving them a taste for garbage and carrion instead of fruit on the vine, and having the added benefit of displacing the native crows, which had pretty well eliminated songbirds from our backyards. The only problem was the noise factor. Something in the mix seemed to have redoubled not only the volume, but the fury of the birds' calls. So half the time you needed earplugs if you wanted to enjoy pretty much any outdoor activity. Which was the case now. The birds were everywhere, cursing fluidly. "Bad bird! Fuck, fuck, fuck!" and flapping their spangled wings in one another's faces. Alarmed, I came down off the porch and for the second time that day scrambled across the lawn to the flower bed where a scrum of birds had settled on the remains of Allison's pet. I flailed my arms and they lifted off reluctantly into the sky, screeching, "Turd bird!" and the fractured call that awakened me practically every morning, "Cocksucker!" As for the pig, which I should have dragged into the garage, I realize that now. Its eyes were gone, and its faintly bluish hide was striped with bright red gashes. Truthfully, I didn't want to touch the thing. It was filthy. The birds were filthy. Who knew what zoonoses they were carrying? So I was just standing there in a quandary when Allison's car pulled into the driveway next door, scattering light. Allison was in her early 30s with a top-heavy figure and a barely tamed kink of ginger hair she kept wrapped up in various scarves, which gave her an exotic look as if she were displaced here in the suburbs. She was sad-faced and sweet, the victim of one catastrophic relationship after another, and I couldn't help feeling protective toward her. A single woman, alone in that big house her mother had left her when she died. So when she came across the lawn, already tearing up, I felt I'd somehow let her down. And before I could think, I'd stripped off my shirt and draped it over the corpse. "Is that her?" she asked, looking down at the hastily covered bundle at my feet. "No," she said, "don't tell me." And then her eyes jumped to mine and she was repeating my name, Roy, 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 as if ringing it in her throat. "Fuck you!" the crow parrots cried from the trees. "Fuck, fuck, fuck!" In the next moment, she flung herself into my arms, clutching me to her so desperately I could hardly breathe. "I don't want to see," she said in a small voice, each syllable a hot puff of breath on the bare skin of my chest. I could smell her hair, the shampoo she used, the taint of sweat under her arms. "The poor thing," she murmured, and lifted her face so I could see the tears blurring her eyes. "I loved her, Roy. I really loved her." This called up a scene from the past, a dinner party at Allison's, Connie and me, another couple, and Allison and her last inamorata, a big-headed boar who worked for animal control, incinerating strays and misfits. Allison had kept the pig in her lap throughout the meal, feeding it from her plate. And afterward, while we sat around the living room cradling brandies and Benedictine, she propped the thing up at the piano where it picked out Twinkle Twinkle Little Star with its modified hooves. "No," I said, agreeing with her. "You don't want to look." "It was a dog, right? That's what..." And here she had to break off a moment to gather herself. "That's what Terry Wolfson said when she called me at work." I was going to offer some platitude about how the animal hadn't suffered, though for all I knew, the dog had gummed it relentlessly, the way it had gummed my arm, when a voice called, "Hello!" from the street behind us, and we broke hastily apart. Coming up the walk was the tall girl, tottering on a pair of platform heels, and she had the dog with her, this time on a leash. I felt a stab of annoyance. Hadn't she caused enough trouble already? And embarrassment, that too. It wasn't like me to go shirtless in public or to be caught in a full-body embrace with my unmarried next-door neighbor, either. If she could read my face, the girl gave no indication of it. She came right up to us, the dog trotting along docilely at her side. Her violet gaze swept from me to the lump on the ground beneath the bloodied T-shirt, and finally to Allison. "Je suis désolée, madame," she said. "Pardonnez-moi, mon chien ne savait pas ce qu'il faisait. Il est un bon chien, vraiment." This girl, this child, loomed over us, her features animated. She was wearing eyeliner, lipstick, and blush, as if she were 10 years older and on her way to a nightclub. And her hair, blonde with a natural curl, spread like a tent over her shoulders and dangled all the way down to the small of her back. "What are you saying?" I demanded. "And why are you speaking in French?" "Because I can. Puedo hablar en español también. Und ich kann auch in Deutsch sprechen. My IQ is 162, and I can run the 100 meters in 9.58 seconds. "Wonderful," I said, exchanging a look with Allison. "Terrific, really. Well, what are you doing here? What do you want?" "Your mother," the birds cried. "Up yours!" The girl shifted from one foot to the other, looking awkward like the child she was. "I just wanted to please, please beg you not to report Ruby to animal control, because my father says they'll come and put her down. She's a good dog, she really is, and she never did anything like this before, and we never, never, ever let her run loose. It was just a freak occurrence," I said. "Right," she said, "an anomaly, an accident." Allison's jaw tightened. The dog looked tranquilly up at us out of its pink eyes as if all this was none of its concern. A bugless breeze rattled the trees along the street. "And what am I supposed to say?" Allison put in. "How am I supposed to feel? What do you want, forgiveness? Well, I'm sorry. I just can't do it, not now." She gave the girl a fierce look. You love your dog? The girl nodded. Well, I loved Shoshana, too. She choked up. More than anything in the world. We all took a moment to gaze down on the carcass. Then the girl lifted her eyes. My father says we'll pay all damages. Here, she said, digging into her purse and producing a pair of business cards, one of which she handed to me and the other to Allison. Any medical treatment you need, we'll take care of, 100%, she assured me, eyeing my arm doubtfully before turning to Allison. And replace your pet, too, if you want, madame. It was a micro pig, right, from Recombacorp? It was a painful moment. I could feel for Allison and the girl, too, though Connie and I didn't have any pets, not even one of the new hypoallergenic breeds. And we didn't have children either, though we discussed it often enough. There was a larger sadness at play here. The sadness of attachment and loss and the way the world wreaks its changes, whether we're ready for them or not. We would have gotten through the moment, I think, coming to some sort of understanding. Allison wasn't vindictive, and I wasn't about to raise a fuss. But that same breeze swept across the lawn to flip back the edge of the T-shirt and expose the eyeless head of the pig, and that was all it took. Allison let out a gasp, and the dog, that crimson freak, jerked the leash out of the girl's hand and went right for it. When Connie came home, I was in the kitchen mixing a drink. The front door slammed. Connie was always in a hurry, no wasted motion. And though I'd asked her 100 times not to slam the door, she was constitutionally incapable of taking the extra 2 seconds to ease it shut. An instant later, her briefcase slapped down on the hallway table with the force of a thunderclap. Her heels drilled the parquet floor, tat, 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 tat. And there she was in the kitchen saying, make me one too, honey, would you? Or no, wine. Do we have any wine? I didn't ask her how her day had gone. All her days were the same, pedal to the metal, one situation after another, all of which she dealt with like a 5-star general driving the enemy into the sea. I didn't give her a hug or blow her a kiss either. We weren't that sort of couple. To her mind, and mine too, to be honest, it would have just been more wasted motion. Wordlessly, I turned to the cabinet, took a glass down from the cupboard, poured her a glass of the Sancerre she liked, and handed it to her. Though I had the window open to catch the breeze, there was no sound of the birds, which must have flown off to haunt somebody else's yard. Allison's pet pig was killed today, I said, right out on the front lawn, by one of those transgenic pit bulls, one of the crimson ones they're always pushing on TV. Her eyebrows lifted. She swirled the wine in her glass, took a sip. And I got bit, I added, holding up my arm where a deep purplish bruise had wrapped itself around the skin just below the elbow. What she said next didn't follow. But then we often talked in non sequitur, she conducting a kind of call and response conversation in her head and I in mine. The responses never quite matching up. She didn't comment on my injury or the dog or Allison or the turmoil I'd gone through. She just set her glass down on the counter, patted her lips where the wine had moistened them and said, I want a baby. I suppose I should back up here a moment to give you an idea of where this was coming from. We'd been married 12 years now, and we'd agreed that at some point we'd like to start a family, but we kept putting it off for one reason or another. Our careers, finances, fear of the way a child would impact our lifestyle, that sort of thing. But with a twist. What sort of child? That was the question. Previous generations had only to fret over whether the expectant mother would bear a boy or girl, or if the child would inherit Aunt Bethany's nose or Uncle Yuri's unibrow. But that wasn't the case anymore. Not since CRISPR gene editing technology hit the ground running 20 years back. Now, not only could you choose the sex of the child at conception, you could choose its other features too, as if having a child were like going to the car dealership and picking the options to add onto the basic model. The sole function of sex these days had become recreational. Babies were conceived in the laboratory. That was the way it was, and that was the way it would be until, as a species, we evolved into something else. The result was a nation. A world of children like the tall girl with the bright red dog. To my way of thinking, this was intrusive and unnatural, but to Connie's, it was a no-brainer. Are you out of your mind, she'd say? Do you really want your kid, our kid, to be the bonehead of the class? Or what, take career training, cosmetology, auto mechanics, for Christ's sake? Now, tipping back her glass and downing the wine in a single belligerent gulp, she announced, I'm 38 years old and I'm putting my foot down. I made an appointment at Gen Lab for 10 a.m. Thursday, and I'm sacrificing a day of work for it, too. Either you come with me, she was glaring at me now, or I swear I'm going to go out and get a sperm donor. Nobody likes an ultimatum, especially when you're talking about a major life-changing event, the kind of thing both people involved have to enter into in absolute harmony. It didn't go well. She thought she could bully me, as if I were one of her underlings at work. I thought she couldn't. She thought she'd had the final word on the subject. I thought different. I said some things I wound up regretting later, snatched up my drink and slammed through the kitchen door and out into the backyard, where for once no birds were cursing from the trees and even the bees seemed muted as they went about their business. What came next was dependent on that silence, because otherwise I never would have heard the soft, heart-sick keening of Allison working through the stations of her grief. The sound was low and intermittent, a stunted release of air followed by a sudden, sodden gargling that might have been the wheeze and rattle of the sprinklers starting up, and it took me a minute to realize what it was and that it was coming from the adjoining yard. In the instant, I forgot all about what had just transpired in my own kitchen and thought of Allison, struck all over again by the intensity of her emotion. We'd managed to get the dog off the carcass, all three of us shouting at once while the girl grabbed for the leash and I delivered two or three sharp kicks to the animal's hindquarters. But Allison's dead pig was none the better for it. The girl, red-faced and embarrassed despite her IQ and whatever other attributes she might have possessed, slouched across the lawn and down the street, the dog mincing beside her, and we both watched till she was gone, at which point I offered to do the only sensible thing and bury what was left of the remains. I dug a hole out back of Allison's potting shed. Allison read a passage I vaguely remembered from high school. The stars are not wanted now. Put out every one. Pack up the moon and dismantle the sun. I held her in my arms for the second time that day, then filled the hole and went home to make my drink and have Connie slam the front door and lay her demands on me. Now, as if I were being tugged on invisible wires, I moved toward the low hedge that separated our properties and stepped across it. The first thing I saw was Allison, hunched over the picnic table on the patio. She was still dressed in the taupe blouse and black skirt she'd worn to work, and she had her head down, her scarf bunched under one cheek. When I got closer, I saw she was crying, and that got to me in a way I can't explain, so that before I knew what I was doing, I'd fallen down a long, dark tunnel and found myself consoling her in a way that seemed, how can I put this, so very natural at the time. It was dark when I got home. Connie was sitting on the couch in the living room watching TV with the sound muted. "Hi," I said, feeling sheepish, feeling guilty. I'd never strayed before and didn't know why I'd done it now, except that I'd been so furious with my wife and so strangely moved by Allison and her grief, as if that's an excuse, and I know it isn't. But trying, like all amateurs, to act as if nothing was out of the ordinary. Connie looked up. I couldn't read her face, but I thought, at least by the flickering light of the TV, that she looked softer, contrite even, as if she'd reconsidered her position, or at least the way she'd laid it on me. "I'm sorry," I said, "but I was upset, okay? I just went for a walk, to clear my head." She had nothing to say to this. "You eat yet?" I asked, to change the subject. She shook her head. "Me either," I said, feeling the weight lift, as if ritual could get us through this. "You want to go out?" "No, I don't want to go out," she said. "I want a baby." And what did I say from the shallow grave of my guilt that was no deeper than the layer of earth I'd flung over the shrunken and lacerated corpse of Allison's pet? I said, okay, we'll talk about it." "Talk about it? The appointment is Thursday, 10 a.m. That's non-negotiable." She was right. It was time to start a family, and she was right about cosmetology and auto mechanics, too. What responsible parent wouldn't want the best for his child, whether that meant a stable home, top-flight nutrition, and the best private school education money could buy, or tweaking the chromosomes in a test tube in a lab somewhere? Understand me, I was under duress. I could smell Allison on me still. I could smell my own fear. I didn't want to lose my wife. I loved her. I was used to her. She was the only woman I'd known these past 12 years and more, an unknown quantity, my familiar. And there she was, poised on the edge of the couch, watching me, her will like some miasma seeping in under the door and through the cracks around the windows until the room was choked with it. It was like the moment in a wrestling match where the whistle blows and the grip gives way and nobody gets pinned to the mat. "Okay," I said. Which is not to say I gave in without a fight. The next day, Wednesday, I had to go into the office and endure the usual banalities of my coworkers till I wanted to beat the walls of my cubicle in frustration. But on the way home, I stopped at a pet store and picked up an 8-week-old dog cat. By the way, people still aren't quite sure what to call the young, even now, 15 years after they were first created. They're not kittens, and they're not puppies, but something in between, as the name of the new species implies. Kit pups, pup kits. The sign in the window read simply, "Baby dog cats on special." And so I picked out a squirming little furball with a doggish face and tabby stripes and brought it home as a surprise for Connie, hoping it would distract her long enough to reevaluate the decision she was committing us to. I tucked the thing inside my shirt on the drive home. Since for the minute the girl behind the counter had put it in its cardboard carrying container, it had begun alternately mewing and yipping in a tragic way, and it nestled there against my chest, warm and content, until I'd parked the car and gone up the steps and into the house. Connie was already home, moving briskly about the kitchen. There were flowers on the table next to an ice bucket with the neck of a bottle of Veuve Clicquot protruding from it, and the room was redolent with the scent of my favorite meal, piperade, Basque style, topped with poached eggs, which I realized she must have made a special stop for at Maison Claude on her way home. This was a celebration, and no two ways about it. In the morning, we would procreate, or take our first steps in that direction, which on my part would involve producing a sperm sample under duress, unlike, I couldn't help thinking, the way it had been with Allison. We didn't hug, we didn't kiss. I just said, "Hey," and she said, "Hey," back. "Smells great," I said, trying to gauge her expression as we both hovered over the table. "Perfect timing," she said, leaning in to adjust the napkin beside her plate that was already precisely aligned. "I got there the minute they took it out of the oven. Claude himself brought it out to me, along with a loaf of that crusty sourdough you like, just baked this morning." I was grinning at her. "Great," I said, "really great." Into the silence that followed, neither of us was ready to address the issue hanging over us. I said, "I've got a surprise for you." "How sweet, what is it?" With a magician's flourish, I whipped the new pet from the folds of my shirt and held it out triumphantly for her. Unfortunately, I seemed to have startled the thing in the process, and it reacted by digging its claws into my wrist, letting out a string of rapid-fire barks and dropping a glistening turd on the tiles of the kitchen floor. "For you," I said. Her face fell. "You gotta be kidding me. You really think I'm that easy to buy off or what, distract?" She made no effort to take the thing from me. In fact, she clenched her hands behind her back. "Take it back where you got it." The pup kit had softened now, retracting its claws and settling into the crook of my arm as if it recognized me, as if in the process of selecting it and secreting it in my shirt, I'd imparted something essential to it, love, that is. And it was content to exist in a new world on a new basis altogether. "It's purring," I said. "What do you want me to say, hallelujah? The thing's a freak. You're saying so yourself every time one of those stupid commercials come on." Suddenly, the jingle was playing in my head, a snatch of the last lulling measures of Pachelbel's canon over which the announcer croons, "Dog person? Cat person? It's all moot now." "No more a freak than that girl with the dog," I said. "What girl? What are you talking about? The one with the dog that bit me? She must have been 6'4". She has an IQ of 162, and still she let the dog out, and still it bit me." "What are you saying? You're not trying to back out on me, are you? We had a deal, Roy, and you know how I feel about people that renege on a deal." Okay, calm down. All I'm saying is maybe we ought to have a kind of trial or something before we, we've never even had a pet." "A pet is not a child, Roy." "No," I said, that's not what I meant. It was just, I'm just..." The crow parrots started up then with one of their raucous dinner time chants, squawking so piercingly you could hear them even with the windows shut. "Big Mac! Big Mac!" they crowed. "Fries!" And I lost my train of thought. "Are we going to eat?" Connie said in a fragile voice. And we both looked first to the microwave and then to the animal excreta on the kitchen floor. "Because I went out of my way," she said, tearing up. "Because I wanted this night to be special, okay?" So now we did hug, though the pup kit got between us. And coward that I am, I told her everything was going to be all right. Later, after she'd gone to bed, I took the pup kit in my arms, went next door, and rang the bell. Allison answered in her nightgown, a smile creeping across her lips. "Here," I said, handing her the animal. "I got this for you." Fast forward 7.5 months. I am living in a house with a pregnant woman next door to a house in which there is another pregnant woman. Connie seems to find this amusing, never suspecting the truth of the matter. We'll glance up from the porch and see Allison emerging heavily from her car with an armload of groceries, and Connie will say things like, "I don't envy her, and I hope she doesn't have to pee every 5 minutes the way I do." And she won't say who the father is. "I just hope it's not that a-hole from animal control. What was his name?" This is problematic on a number of levels. I play dumb, of course. What else could I do? "Maybe she went to Gen Lab," I say. "Her? You're kidding me, right? I mean, look at that string of jerks she keeps dating. If you want to know the truth, Roy, she's lower class, and I'm sorry to have to say it." I'm not about to argue the point. The fact is, I tried everything I could to talk Allison out of going through with this. Finally, to my shame, falling back on the same argument about the whole Ubermensch, Untermensch dynamic Connie had used on me. Trade school, cosmetology, self-denigration, back of the classroom, the works. But Allison merely gave me a bitter smile and said, "I trust your genes, Roy. You don't have to be involved. I just want to do this, that's all, for myself and for nature. You believe in nature, don't you?" "You don't have to be involved." But I was involved, though we'd had sex only the one time, well, two actually, counting the night I brought her the pup kit. And if she had a boy and he looked like me and grew up next door playing with our daughter, how involved would that be? So there comes a day, sometime during the 8th month, a Tuesday, when I'm working at home and Connie's at the office. I'm so focused on the problem at hand, I keep putting off my bathroom break until the morning's nearly gone. It's the way it always is when I'm deeply engaged with a problem, a kind of mind-body separation. But finally, the body's needs prevail, and I push myself up from the desk to go down the hall to the bathroom. I'm standing there in mid-flow when I become aware of the sound of a dog barking on the front lawn. And I shift my torso ever so slightly so that I can glance out the window and see what the ruckus is all about. It's the red dog, the cherry pit that set all this in motion, and he's tearing around on my hybrid lawn, chasing something. My first reaction is anger. Anger at the tall girl and her fixer father and all the other idiots of the world. But by the time I get down the stairs and out the front door into the sunlight, it dissipates, because I see that the dog isn't there to kill anything, but to play, and that what it's chasing is being chased willingly. Allison's dog cat, now a rangy adolescent and perhaps a third the size of the dog. For all my fretting over the lawn, I have to say that in that moment, with the light making a cathedral of the street trees and the neighborhood suspended in the grip of a lazy, warm autumn afternoon, I find something wonderfully liberating in the play of those two animals, the dog cat especially. Allison named him Tiger in respect to his coloration, dark feral stripes against a kind of Pomeranian orange. And he lives up to his name, absolutely fearless and with an athleticism and elasticity that combines the best of both the species that went into making him. He runs rings around the pit bull, actually, feinting one way, dodging the next, racing up the trunk of a tree and out onto a branch before leaping into the next tree and springing back down to charge dog-like across the lawn. "Go, Tiger," I yell out. "Good boy, go get him." That's when I become aware of Allison in a pair of maternity shorts and an enormous top crossing from her front lawn to ours. She's put on a lot of weight, but not as much as Connie, because we opted for a big baby in the 11-pound range, wanting it, her, to have that advantage right from the start. I haven't spoken much with Allison these past months, but I still have feelings for her, beyond resentment, of course. So I lift a hand and wave, and she waves back, and I watch her come barefooted through the glowing grass while the sun sits in the trees and the animals frolic around her. I'm down off the porch now, and I can't help but smile at the sight of her. She comes up to me, moving with a kind of clumsy grace, if that makes any sense. And I want to take her in my arms, but can't really do that, not under these conditions. So I take both my hands and pull her to me to peck a neighborly kiss to her cheek. For a minute, neither of us says anything. Then, shading her eyes with the flat of one hand to better see the animals at play, she says, "Pretty cute, huh?" I nod. "You see how Tiger's grown?" "Yes, of course. I've been watching him all along. Is that as big as he's going to get?" The sun catches her eyes, which are a shade of plain, everyday brown. "Nobody's sure, but the vet thinks he won't get much bigger, maybe a pound or two." "And you," I venture, "how are you feeling?" "Never better. You're going to be seeing more of me. Don't look scared. That's not what I mean. I'm just taking my maternity leave, though. I'm not due for like 6 weeks. Both her hands, pretty hands, shapely, come to rest on the bulge beneath her oversized blouse. They're really being nice about it at work. Connie's not planning to take off till the minute her water breaks, because that's the way Connie is, and I want to tell her that by way of contrast, just to say something. But I notice that she's looking over my shoulder, and I turn my head to see the tall girl coming up the walk, leash in hand. Sorry, the girl calls out. She got loose again. Sorry, sorry. I don't know what it is, but I'm feeling generous, expansive. No problem, I call out. She's just having a little fun. That's when Connie's car slashes into the driveway, going too fast, and all I can think is she's going to hit one of the animals. But she brakes at the last minute, and they flow like water around the tires to chase back across the lawn again. It's hard to gauge the look on my wife's face as she swings open the car door, pushes herself laboriously from behind the wheel, and sets first one foot, then the other on the pavement. I really should go help her, but it's as if I'm frozen in place. Then starts up the walk as if she hasn't seen us. Just as she reaches the front steps, Connie swivels round. I can see she's considering whether it's worth the effort to come greet our neighbor and get a closer look at the tall girl who hovers behind us like the avatar she is, but she decides against it. She just stops a moment, staring, and though she's 30 feet away, I can see a kind of recognition settle into her features, and it has to do with the way Allison is standing there beside me, as if for a portrait or an illustration in a book on family planning, male and female, the XY chromosome and the XX. It's just a moment, and I can't say for certain, but her face goes rigid and she turns her back on us, mounts the steps, and slams the door behind her. When the CRISPR technology first came to light, governments and scientists everywhere assured the public that it would be employed only selectively to fight disease and rectify congenital deformities, editing out the mutated BRCA1 gene that predisposes women to breast cancer, for instance, or eliminating the ability of the Anopheles mosquito to carry the parasite that transmits malaria. Who could argue with that? Genome editing kits, knock out any gene, were sold to home hobbyists who could create their own anomalous forms of yeast and bacteria in their kitchens, and it was revolutionary, and beyond that, fun. Fun to tinker, fun to create. The pet and meat industries gave us rainbow-colored aquarium fish, seahorses that incorporated gold dust in their cells, rabbits that glowed green under a black light, the beefed-up super cow, the micro pig, the dog cat, and all the rest. The Chinese were the first to renounce any sort of regulatory control and upgrade the human genome. And as if they weren't brilliant enough already, they became still more brilliant as the first edited children began to appear. And of course, we had to keep up. In a room at GenLab, Connie and I were presented with an exhaustive menu of just how our chromosomes could be made to match up. We chose to have a daughter. We selected emerald eyes for her. Not iridescent, not freakishly bright, but enhanced for color so that she could grow up wearing mint, olive, Kelly green, and let her eyes talk for her. We chose height, too, as just about everybody did. And musical ability. We both love music. Intellect, of course. And finer features, too, like a subtly cleft chin and breasts that would be optimal. Not too big, but not as small as Connie's, either. It was a menu, and we placed an order. The tall girl is right beside us now, smiling like the heroine of a Norse saga, her eyes sweeping over us like searchlights. She looks to Allison, takes in her condition. Boy or girl, she asks. The softest smile plays over Allison's lips. She ducks her head, shrugs. The girl, the genius, looks confused a moment. But, how can that be? You don't mean you... But before Allison can answer, a crow parrot sweeps out of the nearest tree, winging low to screech, "Fuck you!" in our faces. And the smallest miracle occurs. Tiger, as casual in his own skin as anything there is or ever was, erupts from the ground in a rocketing whirl of fur to catch the thing in its jaws. As quick as that, it's over. And the feathers, the prettiest feathers you'll ever see, lift and dance and float away on the breeze. Thank you. So thank you very much, folks. I love to present you with literature. It's nice to talk about it, but I love to actually give it to you. I'm channeling my mother's voice. She's the one who taught me how to read. And my eighth grade English teacher, Donald Grant, who was an amateur actor, and on Fridays, if we were good, he would read stories aloud to us, the old chestnuts like To Build a Fire and The Most Dangerous Game and so on. So I really loved to do it and remind everybody, particularly the youth, that stories are fun and they're cool, and that's why we love literature. So that said, oh, and one further detail about this story. Okay, so I'm projecting 20 years in the future. So at the end, there's a list of the animals that have been transgenically created, including the dog cat and the crow parrot, which of course don't exist yet. But the others do. All the others mentioned already do exist. So I don't know. I don't know. You think about the consequences of all this. I'm happy to take your questions for our remaining time. And then you're all invited to get on the airplane with me and fly back to New York.
Just a couple of questions.
Yes.
The story, you got a little humor in this one, but it reminds me of the first story by you I ever read, which was We Are Norsemen.
Ah.
Sort of a bit of a whacked out Woody Allen humor.
I love that comment because I'm always trying to do something different. And with some of the stories of this new book, this is part of a new book that comes out next year, The Relive Box and Other Stories, I wanted to just come back to that kind of crazy off-the-wall humor. Although, that said, there are other stories in the book, like The Fugitive, which was in The New Yorker in June, which is a straightforward drama about a guy who has multiply drug-resistant tuberculosis and is then being hunted down by the police. Even though he's not committed a crime, he's going to kill all of us if we don't put him in jail. So, yeah, that's a great observation.
Just one other quick question. There are two people from Santa Barbara that I've grown up with and grown old with. You're one of them. The other one is Berkeley Breathitt, who writes Bloom County comic strip. Do you guys know each other?
No.
I've always wanted to be a...
No, I know of him, but when you come out, introduce us.
Yeah, please. I'd love to be a fly on a wall at a dinner party with you two.
Oh, thanks.
I was wondering if you remember getting a tweet from a Miami-Dade professor saying that they had taught this story to their college class and they noticed in the New Yorker a typo, which I found very funny. And also, will we possibly be seeing any T.C. Boyle movie adaptations anytime soon?
Well, I don't work in the movies and never will. My job is to create my life's work, which is what I'm presenting to you now. I'm an artist. I don't want to, you know, work with anybody. I couldn't imagine making a creative decision in a committee. You know, I couldn't imagine that. That said, yeah, there are always many thousands of movies of my things in the works, and you know, hardly ever do they get made. But The Terranauts is going to be a TV series that looks like a go. Also, my second novel, Budding Prospects, is similarly for Amazon, is going to be a TV series. You know, but I'm not involved, except maybe I'll be a consultant and say, hey, why don't you do this? The Drop City is getting some interest too. You know, as you know, it had been optioned by Deborah Winger for a couple of years and tried to make a movie and she never got it made. But I love movies and I hope that people make wonderful movies of my work because then it will get the message out to a bigger audience who will read the books. But beyond that, I don't really involve myself too much.
So I wanted to say hello from another Peekskillite. Weren't you born in Peekskill, New York?
I was indeed, and who might that be?
Carrie Wallstein. Did you go to school there, or are you?
Lakeland High School.
There you go. I went to PHS 60.
Wow, how wonderful.
So I was just there, and I knew you were coming here, and I said, well, I have to say hello.
And you've made your escape to Miami, I see.
I actually went to Ohio State first.
Well, you're a wise woman.
Anyway, welcome.
Okay, thank you. Others? No problem. I mean, I'll be back in 2 years. You can ask me then. All right. Thanks.